Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Many Daughters of Afong Moy, a novel by Jamie Ford. Read by Jennifer Lim, Cindy Kay, Natalie Naudus, Mirai, Sura Sue, Emily Wu Zeller, and Nancy Wu. With a note read by the author.
This book is for anyone with a complicated origin story. I feel you. We all have some experience of a feeling, of what we are saying and doing, having been said and done before, in a remote time, of our having been surrounded dim ages ago by the same faces, objects, and circumstances. Charles Dickens. As far back as I can remember, I have unconsciously referred to the experiences of a previous state of existence. Henry David Thoreau. I saw that. Karma. Author's note. My first concert was Van Halen in 1984. Yes, I'm of a certain vintage. I wedged my scrawny 15-year-old self through the tube-topped crowd all the way to the barricade. Packed in like a sardine, I watched David Lee Roth in leopard print spandex toss his bleached mane all over the stage of the Seattle Center Coliseum. The evening was hot, sweaty, redolent of weed, and so loud that some days I swear my ears are still ringing from Ain't Talking About Love. So, imagine my surprise when decades later my 12-year-old son Taylor asked, "Have you ever heard of this band called Van Halen?" I'd never played any classic rock for him. We listened to a lot of Radio Disney in those days. And he somehow bumped into the quartet on YouTube and declared them the best band ever. At least until he discovered Genesis. Not the chapter in the Old Testament, but the prog rock group fronted by Peter Gabriel and later Phil Collins. Genesis was another band I was into as a kid, and within weeks my son anointed this group the best band ever. At the time, I thought this was a strange and humorous parent-child coincidence. But years later, while reading about transgenerational epigenetic inheritance, I wondered if something else was going on, something in the genes, or rather, a lot of somethings, creating a genetic proclivity for a certain kind of jam. I mean, he inherited my hairline and my overbite. Why not my questionable taste in music? Epigenetics, combined with the philosophical idea of determinism, made me wonder if free will is, if not an illusion, a bit of a mirage. That, in addition to the environment we grow up in, the contour and texture of our lives are shaped, in part, by some form of genetic predetermination. One way to see this is with identical twins, since they have identical genomes. Take the uncanny case of the Jim twins. In 1940, they were separated at birth and put up for adoption, each finding new homes 3 weeks later. It would be nearly four decades before the brothers crossed paths and discovered some startling similarities. Both had a dog named Toy. Both enjoyed woodworking. Both married women named Linda, divorced, and then both married women named Betty. Both had sons named James Allen and James Allen. Both were plagued with migraines. Both worked in law enforcement. Both vacationed on the same Florida beach. The list goes on. Granted, not all identical twins have patterns of behavioral similarity, but when they do, it seems preternatural. You see where I'm going with this. The idea of epigenetic inheritance has long been embraced in many communities. Native Americans have talked about living with generational trauma for as long as I can remember, and a hotly debated study of Holocaust survivors appears to show a higher percentage of PTSDs, depression, and anxiety in their children and grandchildren. But the most captivating example was a study of laboratory mice that were exposed to a cherry blossom fragrance as the floor of their cage was electrified. I'm so sorry, mice. The mice were quickly conditioned to panic whenever they smelled that scent. But generations later, the descendants of those mice would have the same fear reaction to that smell, even though they had never experienced that pain and discomfort in their own lifetimes. They had inherited that trauma. Take a moment and think about your own family, their joys and calamities. Do you see similarities? Do you see patterns of repetition? rhythms of good and bad decision-making, cycles of struggle and triumph. For purposes of fiction, I based this novel around an iconic woman who made front-page headlines in nearly every newspaper in the country, only to later disappear. I wanted to give her descendants and an epigenetic legacy as broad and tragic as her own. In 1834, that woman set her tiny, bound foot upon the dirty streets of New York City. She was, whether she wanted to be or not, the first Chinese woman to come to America. Identified in the press as Julia Fuchi Ching Chang King, Miss Ching Chang Fu, and Miss Keo Kwong King, she would eventually go by the name Afong Moy, though most simply referred to her as the Chinese lady. Her early life in China is undocumented, but her middle years are a combination of fame and exploitation. Patrons paid 50 cents each to watch her perform in New York, Philadelphia, Richmond, Charleston, New Orleans, and Boston. And while on tour in Washington, D.C., she traveled to the White House at the behest of President Andrew Jackson. Racehorses were named after her. Men wrote poems about her. The public was caught up in speculation about her prospects for marriage. Her later years, however, involved P.T. Barnum being discarded in favor of another younger Chinese performer, and eventually being relegated to a poorhouse in New Jersey, forever hobbled by her bound feet. In 1850, she vanished from the headlines forever and existed only in rumor. That she was touring Europe, that she finally returned home to China, that she had died on the street, homeless and alone. When it comes to epigenetics, the transmission of trauma makes headlines because its manifest symptoms are more easily observed and reported. But the hopeless romantic in me couldn't help but wonder if other things are passed down genetically, like stratums of empathy, levels of limerence, and even the capacity or incapacity for love. The more you think about it, if the genetic circuitry of trauma is intertwined with the genetic circuitry of wellness, together they form an intergenerational feedback loop, where a parent's output is used as input for a child's future behavior. And while there is the latent possibility of cycles repeating themselves, if we understand who and where we came from, genetic destinies can be altered, hopefully for the better. Or, to put it in classic rock terms, if Van Halen's albums were generations, the first generation's songs were "Ain't Talkin' 'Bout Love," but 6 or 7 generations later, it was all "When It's Love, Why Can't This Be Love?" and "Love Walks In." Don't get me started on Jamie's crying.
Act 1.
1. Fei. 1942. Fei Moy signed a contract stating that she would never marry. That's what the American Volunteer Group had required of all female recruits. Though as she sat in the bar of the Kunming Tennis Club, Fei thought that perhaps there should have been an exception made for older nurses. Not that she had any immediate prospects among the 30 young officers who made up the Flying Tigers. It was just that a notarized statement of marital exclusion seemed to hammer home the fact that she'd never been in love. She'd come close once, back in her village near Canton, amid the wilted lilies of her youth. Since then, she'd felt many things for many people, but always more yearning than devotion, more appreciation than passion. There had even been an awkwardly arranged marriage proposal a lifetime ago at the Toto Koi restaurant, where a dashing young man got down on one knee with a ring and too much pomade in his hair. "Wasted." That's what her father said when she turned him down. "Fei Jin, why do you have to be this way? No one likes a stubborn girl." She'd tried not to roll her eyes.
"Why can't you call me Fei like everyone else?"
"Because I'm not everyone else. Look at you. You're not getting any younger. You should be happy someone still wants you at your age."
She'd been 27. But as much as Fei had wanted to share her life with someone,
to watch a sunset in the arms of somebody who wouldn't leave before sunrise. Even then, she knew that want was not the same as need. She'd refused to settle for convenience, or to abet her aching loneliness. She went to Lingnan University instead. She told herself that if she stopped looking, eventually the right person would come along. That was decades ago. Now she felt like the jigsaw puzzle of her life had long been completed. The picture looked whole, but there was one piece missing. "That's my heart," Faye thought. "Something extra. Unnecessary." Now well into her 50s, Faye still couldn't forget how in nursing school, Chinese mothers used to point at her as she walked down the street in the evening. They'd turn to their daughters and say, "Don't be disobedient, or you'll end up like her." Or, "That's what happens when you're too proud, too foolish. No one wants you." Faye would pretend she didn't hear. Then she'd run home and curl up in bed, crying herself to sleep. In the morning, she'd light a Chesterfield and stare at the tobacco-stained ceiling, aching inside, as tendrils of smoke drifted upward like unanswered prayers. To her parents and those mothers on the street, Faye was Mei-Fan-Noi-Zi, though she didn't feel like an old maid. Even after she arrived in Kunming, where she was twice the age of the American nurses who followed. On the bustling streets of Kunming, Faye was treated differently, perhaps because she'd served longer and now hardly noticed the suffocating humidity of typhoon season, or because she didn't scream when field rats crawled their way into her dresser and chewed the buttons off her clothing. Conceivably, it was because she was fluent in English, thanks to Lai King, her American-born mother, and could quote poetry by Li Bai, as well as Gertrude Stein and Oscar Wilde, yet also spend an entire afternoon playing canasta and whist while drinking tiger bombs, and not let the rum cocktails make her sick for days. Faye learned early on to avoid not only the whiskey the natives made, but especially the gin concocted by Jesuit missionaries. "You want another?" Faye shook her glass tumbler. Lois, the latest nursing recruit, a comely blonde from Topeka, looked back, bleary-eyed.
"Am I supposed to say yes? What is this, some kind of initiation?"
Faye noticed that Lois was slurring her words, so she peered over the recruit's shoulder and made eye contact with the bartender. Faye shook her head, almost imperceptibly, so Lois wouldn't catch on, then nodded as the barkeep put his bottle away.
"I don't know why everyone around here drinks so much," Lois said, waving broadly at everyone in the club. "And why do they have to play such sad music?"
Faye listened to the jukebox as Frank Sinatra sang, "I'll Never Smile Again." She thought about the flashes of light on the horizon each night, the peals of thunder, followed by the rumble of pony carts on cobbled streets in the morning, and the wailing of widows as refugees flooded through the city's arched gates. "It comes with the territory," Faye said, as she worried about her parents, whom she hadn't heard from in 2 years. She finished her drink, leaving only a mint leaf. "The mountains will protect us," Faye had been told when she first arrived, even after Shanghai, Nanking, and Hangzhou fell. Then word spread that the defenses around Chongqing had collapsed, and the wind began carrying the malodorous smell she'd learned to recognize as the fetor of burning bodies. Japanese bombers killed thousands of civilians in last week's raids, along with 6 American pilots. President Roosevelt, who had sent planes and men, publicly denied U.S. involvement in the war between China and Japan. But after Pearl Harbor, there was no need for the pretense. And now everyone in Kunming knew who the Americans were.
"I can't believe they made all the nurses swear we'd never marry," Lois said, as an aviator walked by with eyes like Gary Cooper and a smile like Jin Yan. Faye shook her head, grumbling. They should have made the men swear an oath as well.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.